Welcome to Moby Mondays.
Good evening. I'm Yvette Moyo, and welcome to Moby Marketing Opportunities in Business and Entertainment. Our symposium series has quite a legacy, and I'll share it with you for those of you who are here for the first time at our Moby Monday series, which, by the way, is just gone far beyond our imagination in terms of how many times people will come on a Monday to listen to our platform. That the hunger is there for to see each other, what we've done, what we've achieved, and how we can work together to do more together. Moby, Marketing Opportunities in Business and Entertainment, was a symposium series that started over 25 years ago. And we did it twice a year with because our company, our marketing firm, was having a great time working with the Black entertainment and sports lawyers to raise money for them, and also doing productions here in Chicago at the Regal Theater with people like Sinbad and Adele Givens and Al Jarreau, et cetera. So we were on one side of the business in sales, helping a professional organization, and the other side of the business, we were actually doing productions. So we were having such a great time that we said, if these corporate people could meet these music people, right? Every music person wants to meet the vice president of marketing, or at that time it was the Black marketing division of corporations, right? And every corporate person wants to know, how do I meet those people at Time Warner and Universal and Columbia Records? And we had the contacts on both sides. So we launched our Moby Symposium. What kept us going this long? We were on hiatus for about 12 years. Everybody knows about the economic downturn, but the Moby deals, what we impressed upon people is to do deals with each other, people that look like ourselves. We got the talent, our culture influences everything. So why couldn't we do deals with each other? And so that's why for 12 years, when we weren't having conferences, people were still calling me to say, I just did a Moby deal. Meaning they met somebody at Moby and they purposefully found that person to do a deal with because of the trust and the principles of Moby. I'm not going to talk any longer than that because we are getting ready to hear something amazing. This panel is the music and the sound and culture of Minneapolis. If you didn't grow up with that sound, I don't know when you were born. It was amazing. It was an amazing coming of age for us and our music. And I just honor and respect the people on this panel that you're going to hear tonight. Thank you for joining us. And I'm going to turn it over to Wendy Wheaton to lead this discussion. Thank you so much.
Wendy? Thank you so much, Yvette. As she said, it's amazing. We have a wonderful show right now. And I'm Wendy Wheaton. I want to thank everyone for tuning in to Moby Symposium today. As Yvette said, Moby stands for Marketing Opportunities in Business and Entertainment. Today, our topic is the music and the movement of Minneapolis specifically. And we're going to talk about Minneapolis, where incredible artists and musicians came from Minneapolis, like Sounds of Blackness, Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis, Stokley, Prince, The Time, even Lizzo hailed from Minneapolis. But this year, in May 2020, this city of musical geniuses made a different type of news worldwide with the killing of George Floyd, which led to global protest and a movement to stand up for Black Lives Matter. Today, our esteemed panel will share their journey growing up and working in Minneapolis and their part in the Minneapolis signature sound, as well as taking a stand to social injustice in the United States and around the world. I would like to introduce my esteemed panel today. My guests include the exemplary Gary D. Hines, leader and music director of Sounds of Blackness, three-time Grammy winner Stokley, formerly of Mint Condition, Kevin Fleming, program director of KPFK Los Angeles and owner of Urban Buzz, and Jacqui Thompson, president of PRN Prince Roger Nelson Alumni Foundation. Thank you all for joining me. Welcome. You're welcome. I'd like to start my first question with Mr. Gary. Gary, you created the group Sounds of Blackness in 1971. I cannot believe that. I've been grooving and jamming with Sounds of Blackness. And you were at McAllister College in Minneapolis when you started the group, and it was a 30-piece band and an orchestra way back then, like first and foremost, and a mixture of R&B and gospel. But many people remember the 1991 hit, Optimistic. That was one of my favorites. So we're going to show you a little bit of optimistic coming up as soon as we can get it. Gary, I want to start off and just say, you know, everything that you have done has just been amazing.
Thank you so much on behalf of Sounds of Blackness.
Wow. Okay. We brought back some wonderful memories. Woo-hoo. Thank you, Gary. I saw you in there. Wow. I want to open it up, Gary. We're celebrating 50 years, five decades since you started this group, Sounds of Blackness, that's still relevant. I'm going to start you off with my first question. Being from Minneapolis, tell us, you know, why Minneapolis is so special to you and the musical talent that emerged from that city.
Thank you so much for all that love, Wendy. I'm actually a New Yorker, so shout out to Yonkers, New York. But the relevance of that to your question is that when our family moved to Minneapolis from Yonkers, we found a very small but a very vibrant Black community, and especially musically. There were R&B groups here that rivaled the Motown groups, Midwest Express, Showtime Part 1 and 2, Maurice McGinnis and the Blazers, the Amazers, names that you probably don't know, but I'm telling you, the rival the Motown groups, and the same was true for blues, for gospel, for jazz, which is what brought the Hineses to Minneapolis. My mom, the late, great jazz singer, Bass Hines, was booked for 2 weeks, but held over for a year. Minneapolis was a big jazz town. Ellington and Basie were here all the time. And so that's how we got here. And that's what was going on even back in the 50s and 60s.
Right. Okay. And so in the 50s and 60s, and now we're in 2020, yes. How does Sounds of Blackness 50 years later stay relevant to some of the younger, you know, industry people that don't even know who Sounds of Blackness might be?
By always being rooted in the community, the great Paul Robeson once said, all true artists have a responsibility to their people. And we take that very seriously. We were groomed that way by Stokley's father, the great Professor Mahmoud El-Khadi. Stokley and I's family go back to the 60s. So Prince, all we didn't evolve in a vacuum. We came from a rich music pool that was pre-existing. Somebody said, what's in the water in Minneapolis? But you know, there were a lot of really creative Black folks here that you've never heard of, from which a Prince, a Stokley, a Sounds of Blackness emerged from.
Right. And someone that knows about this talent is Mr. Kevin Fleming, program director of KPFK in Los Angeles and also the Urban Buzz, someone I've known for several years that is just a mover and a shaker. Welcome, Kevin.
Thank you, Wendy. And yeah. Let me just say, first of all, Gary looks great for 105 years old. That is amazing.
Right? How do you do it?
Man. I grew up on the Sounds when I was a kid. I didn't know he was been around that long. My God,
something's not adding up. I don't think.
In 1971, I was in high school. I was in high school.
71, we were. So he's doing something right. I love it, Kevin. Now you were around in Minneapolis, and you know, with all of these groups from Sounds of Blackness, Prince, Jimmy Jam, and Terry Lewis, and even Stokely and Mint Condition, and you know. Tell us your relationship with these artists as a program director and an owner and a president of record labels.
Well, Minneapolis is some wonderful memories. That's my hometown. I bleed purple, as you can tell.
Yeah.
I grew up on a street that across the street was a kid named Andre Anderson. And his mother and my grandmother were best friends. I'm talking about thick as thieves. Mm-hmm. And his friend became my friend, and his name was, we called him Skipper.
Right.
And he had a big fro, little short guy. We'd ride bikes together. We'd play basketball together. We'd run track together. Whatever we did together. Because, again, we lived across the street from one another. So to see young men like Andre and Skipper and Morris Day, who was around the corner, and Terry Lewis, who I played high school football with, and so many others. You know, we in Minneapolis, we have two seasons, you know, either summer or winter. So I think we all kind of woodshed in the winter. And one year we were playing ball, the next year somebody was playing a bass. So it's just amazing to see the growth and development and having been a part of that and to be able to witness that.
Right.
One of the things that happened every year, once some of the groups, the local groups, had gotten established, is we used to have this thing called the Battle of the Bands. I know Gary remembers that. They'd have a battle of the bands outside at Phyllis Wheatley, and all the bands would come out there and do their little battle, and there'd be Grand Central with Prince and Andre, and there'd be Flight Time with Jimmy, with Terry and his group, and David Island and right. So many people, and then there'd be Sonny Thompson and them with the family or Back to Black, and these guys would battle. And from my point of view, I was one of the MCs on the show, so I'm announcing the group. So it's a family, it's a history, it's a wonderful thing to see these guys come from such humble beginnings to be right. So great, and in Prince's case, obviously worldly. We always knew that Skipper was going to be talented and was talented. We just never knew he'd be as talented as he turned out to be.
So wait, you hung out with Skipper Prince when he was a kid?
Oh, before he picked up instruments. When they were playing on cardboard boxes, we were running the streets together. So this goes way, way back. I can't wait to hear Stokley's when he talks about Prince, because they had a different type of relationship and what they did. So it's just amazing that we all could come together now and really talk about something that was so dear to us and so natural for us. Yeah. Like I said, Sounds of Blackness was in the Minneapolis scene long before they made it to the national scene when we were signed to Prospective Records.
And they had been established. That's so special to me, because not only were you in Minneapolis and you've traveled as a program director all around the nation at different stations in DC and Los Angeles, but it's so special that you were the general manager and vice president even when I worked at A&M Records and Perspective, and that goes way back.
Yeah.
And how I met Gary back then. And so, but you as a VP and GM were very instrumental in breaking this song Optimistic. Let's just talk about that a little bit. Three Grammys.
I came into the company at that time when the song had just been released and it was doing well. And my responsibility was to share that information with radio across the country and promote that product and make sure that people knew who they were. You know, of course, one of the challenges to Sounds of Blackness is you can't really take 40 or 50 people around with you everywhere you go. So we had to have this touring group. I'm sure Gary will jump in on that. A small subset of the big group, and we used to go around and promote the record. But we also promoted Mint Condition, and Stokley will jump in on that as to how we start working that. And then my first big challenge was Pretty Brown Eyes.
Oh my!
And the challenge I say is because when I got there, A&M didn't really know what to do with Mint Condition, so they were saying, "Well, we're going to move to another record." I said, "No, you're not. We're going to stick with this." And we had a hit record with Pretty Brown Eyes, and I'm sure that Stokley will attest to that.
Well, let's get to it. We can't wait any longer for Stokley. Mr. Stokley, he's a vocalist, a songwriter. He plays multiple instruments, and you guys all know him. He is a solo artist now, but 30 years later, Pretty Brown Eyes is one of my favorite songs. Stokley, welcome.
Thank you. So glad to be here.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Now, you have a lot of history. Y'all look very young, and you're still young, but you go back, you know, several decades here. what, tell us your relationship with Gary and Sounds of Blackness, and we'll talk about your solo career.
Well, a long time ago, Gary gave me this bottle of water. So that's why I look like this.
Oh, you know, here we go. Here we go.
And I have the same jug. Eh?
The Fountain of Youth.
Fountain of Youth. But all seriousness, I have to say happy 50th to the Sounds of Blackness.
Thank you, brother.
It's, you know, it's thinking about this. It goes back so far. I remember on the McAllister campus, I used to go watch Gary play football on the weekend at, you know, McAllister College. It's amazing just to see everything that has happened. I have fond memories of that. There was this place on campus called the Black House. I mean, the Black House is where they used to get meetings and they rehearsed there. And I was just around all of this just richness. And I always say, people say, you know, with the, you know, the music that you do and the, what I've been a part of with Mint Condition, you know, is it's been, you know, pretty much the genre or the branches of the trees of African-American music. And I think what I do is just like, it's like a abbreviated version of what the Sounds of Blackness is about, basically, is my thing. Because it's, you know, Sounds of Blackness being about, you know, field hollers, spirituals, gospel, rhythm and blues, all the branches of the tree of black music, everything that we brought here. So I'm always going to have tinges of that. And I just remember, I mean, I can't, I'm just on their shoulders. You know, Kevin Fleming, you know, oh, somebody talking, oh, somebody coming to you there. We go, I mean, fast forward to, you know, the perspective days for Kevin Fleming. I mean, we just had so much fun. And I remember it was definitely like a community, He was talking about how, you know, A&M kind of didn't hear what was going on. Let's move to this, at the next single. Jimmy and Terry, Kevin, all of us, we knew what it was, you know, as far as the how we were moving, and like we knew what worked, you know, our community. We knew our language. It was only when you got outside of our community they didn't understand, you know, what it was. It's like, you know, we didn't hear the single. We never, you know, pretty much every single that we released, somebody on the outskirts didn't really get it. You know, it was always something. So, I mean, I thank you, Kevin. You know, I mean, it's amazing. I mean, this is part of our history. I just,
well, you were before your time.
I'm sorry?
You were before your time.
I guess so. It was just an amazing experience. I'm just overwhelmed just here. I'm having flashbacks and I'm thinking back now. all this greatness that, you know, we're standing on top of, and, you know, Jacqui Thompson, I mean, just worked with her and just her just brilliant, you know, as both the gentlemen said, so many people that you don't hear about, you've never heard about, that I've inspired, the same bands, you know, Midwest Express, Cohesion, all these St. Paul groups, you know, Grand Central. For me, it's been just a pleasure and honor to see, you know, Prince in his early days, you know, at the Phyllis Wheatley Festival, all these things that just amazing, you know, KMOJ, all these people have been just a great inspiration. And, you know, this is the village that we talk about. This is what it looks like, you know?
Right. I think it's great. It is a village. It's a community. We all have our own stories and the fabric that's interwoven. I told Kevin, you know, I worked at A&M when you guys were all signed with Janet Jackson, and I used to roller skate from the A&M lot down to Perspective. And it's great to see everybody. I'd be picking up checks for people. So, you know, however you've been involved, wow, you always have that history. And, you know, speaking of history, now you're a solo artist, Stokley, and, you know, you've certainly got, you know, great sound. But I want to talk to some of the people that are musicians that are watching, and are record companies, do you think, still viable these days? And are more artists becoming solo artists?
Yes, they hold a purpose. I think, you know, as you know, time's always changing every decade, you know, and technology's always been at the forefront. You have to always know where that is, you know, because that's always going to, in any industry, the technology is going to push any industry forward. So the things that I always say that for younger artists that are coming along and want to be in this industry, there's a few things. Is, you know, one of them I always say is your skill set. Just work on that. Work on your craft. Know, you know, something about history, who was before you, what they did, you know, and because that's, if you're trying to have a career, that is, if you're just trying to have a moment, then it's just, you know, right, popularity, then it's not going to last. That's always at the forefront of my mind, you know, trying to push yourself to go outside the box, push yourself into places that may be a little uncomfortable, because we all know that's where we learn, you know. Yeah. And the other thing would be pay attention to the business, you know, and not just people, you know, not just musicians, but maybe this is a business that is filled with so much. You know, you have agents, you have lawyers, you have people who put on shows, promoters, you know, learn something about a little bit of all of that, you know, how your industry runs, the business of it. And of course, the technology. And the technology, you know, brings to, you know, do we need labels? I mean, we're at the point now where the distributor is, you know, the technology. You know, we can make a song tonight, me and Gary and somebody in China can hear it. It's distributed, you know, through these, through the internet, which is an amazing thing. However, you still have to have a team of people. It's always the good people who, you know, don't do what you do, who are as good as what they do, as you are, you know, good at what they do as good as you are what you do. Right. So, I mean, to surround yourself with these great folks. So it's just a little bit of everything, you know, just keep your integrity, you know, at the same time, having your own voice. I remember growing back, you know, listening, we're talking about the 70s. One thing that they, that really struck me is just like everybody had their own voice, you know, and we prided ourselves on that, you know, being different, you know, it's like, oh, such and such is doing it different. You know, it's like, and the whole world is pretty much, just this kind of microwave or homogenized kind of, you know, monolithic thing that we got going on. But I think that just comes from the people in Madison Avenue saying, oh, they got something over there. Let's get something like that. Well, you know, who wants a copy of a copy of a copy of a copy?
Right.
You know, it becomes so watered down like that. You know, be original. It's okay to hear what's going on and say, you know, let me take a little bit of that, and a little bit of that. That's how you get a Sounds of Blackness. So you get, you know, somebody like me or Mint Condition, you know. We keep it fresh, but keep your integrity, you know. Okay. So a lot of these things, like I said, again, your skill set, the business, the technology to move those things, a lot of other things, but those things I always say are pretty much the legs of it for me. And, you know, I'm trying to, at this point in my career, this journey, I'm trying to gather as a musicians who I work with, whether I'm producing or whatever it is, I'm always trying to spread whatever it is that I know, whatever it is that I can do. Whatever my career does for you elevates, and you know, it's going to do the same for me. I'm always inspired by all these people as well. So, you know, just trying to keep the ball rolling. But those are some of the things I would share with them, you know.
Well, thanks, Stokely. We're going to come back and talk about one of your new singles that you have. But now you talked about a whole team effort and this wonderful woman right here, Jacqui Thompson, which you guys know. We're so happy to have you. Thank you for coming, Jacqui. Jacqui is the president, as I said, of Prince Roger Nelson PRN Alumni Foundation. And she is just a trailblazer in the years that she has been involved with Prince and his Alumni Foundation now, and was the president of the record label. You know, Jacqui, you have a lot of stories about Prince. But first, you know, I want to tell some about your background, because you originally were from London via Michigan and found your way with all of these wonderful gentlemen to Minneapolis.
I know.
Yeah. So tell us just how you ended up working with Prince in Minneapolis.
Well, first of all, I listened to all of you guys and was so inspired, coming from a different perspective, coming from Michigan, listening to the early part of Minneapolis sound was so amazing, and it inspired me. And I was at that point, I was trying to figure out what I wanted to do. I had a band, and interesting enough, I had sent a demo tape to Perspective to up to Flight Time. And A&R, Sonia Cates was A&R at the time. Mm-hmm. And she got back to me within a week. And she said, oh, I'm digging your band and I love your package. And we started connecting. And I decided to come up. She said, hey, there's a Minnesota Black Music Awards with Pete Rhodes is doing a concert. They do awards. They have a conference. So I said, hey, well, I'm going to pack up and come up there and see Minneapolis. That's when I fell in love with it. And actually, I call it my home because it was my first home that I chose to be in. And I met Stokley and Gary and Kevin a couple times, but actually in later on in different entertainment, different places. And Pete Rhodes, and I fell in love with it. I came up and did a show up in Minneapolis at the State Theater, Javita Steele. It was all female band. I played drums for it, and met Craig Rice and a bunch of people, and it just was like, this is my, like, this is my place. So I moved up and started just getting to know all the musicians around town, and I knew that, you know, I love drums, but I knew my passion was branding. My passion was helping artists. I knew I'd be, that's my calling, to help other artists. Mm-hmm. So I learned all about everything from the recording studio to booking acts. I used to, just before I started working with Prince, I was working at a club called Biscuits and Blues. I don't know if you guys remember. It had the blues on the bottom and really great soul food on top with the chicken and biscuits. And I started booking like Sugar Blue and a bunch of different, Etta James and a bunch of different artists. And then I got a call from Mike Scott, who's the guitarist with Prince. And he said that there was an opening there. I ended up getting an opportunity to work out at Paisley. And so I started in a, Prince was so innovative. I started in 1-800-NEW-FUNK. It was his online merchandise company. And literally in Paisley Park, there was a people would, around the world would call in and order his perfumes, his cassette tapes, his albums, whatever, t-shirts or whatever. And so I was ahead of really kind of running that. And then it just grew from there. I worked with his first wife, Maite. And then it just grew from there. And then I ended up running his company with, you know, obviously there's a team, a small team, but it was amazing. And when I was there, there weren't any, he didn't want any titles, really. But once in a while, he'd pop out, well, aren't you the president of MPG Records? Oh, I am. so conveniently.
That's so cool.
But it was, like, he was so innovative. And
yeah.
Yeah, that was funny. So I get those little surprises here and there. And so
now
with
you're
that,
running his foundation.
Yes, yeah. So we really decided after he passed, we did a celebration and got invited as many people as we could to get together and celebrate his life from hairdressers and managers and studio and engineers and musicians. And we didn't know how many people were going to come, but 300 people came to the event in November of 2016. And so from that, while we were doing that event, a couple of people that worked for him had health issues. And so we decided to create a little bit of merchandise and raise the money that night. And we did. And then it was a light bulb as we were leaving. It was so much love and such a great weekend. We decided, hey, let's create a nonprofit that really takes his legacy from that standpoint. We knew the music standpoint legacy was going to be there, but a lot of people didn't know how much he gave privately, and his philanthropic side of him was so incredible. I saw it firsthand so many times, and we really wanted to keep that going. So that's how it started. That was
like
the
kettle. Prince gave back, and a lot of people don't realize that he really empowered women. If you think
Absolutely.
About all the women that were in his bands, as you said, and that's just incredible that you're continuing the legacy. And people can go to prnalumnifoundation.org.
PRNalumni.org.
PRNalumni.org. And support and donate, because Jacqui's doing incredible things, and we're going to, you know, have some things coming up that we can work on with you. All of this
fantastic.
Whole
thing. Right,
Kevin,
yeah, that sounds great.
Let's move into it. I want you all to give me your, we all have a Prince story. If you ever met Prince. Jacqui, my first question to you is, what's something special about Prince that people may not have known?
Well, there's a lot, but the one that always surprised me when I started working with him was that most people thought he was very quiet. But he was actually really funny. And when he got comfortable with you, he would talk your head off for hours. And I was shocked the first time. Like, I was up in the conference room and we'd go up there and start. And he talked for like 2 or 3 hours. I had like work to do. I had MTV calls and the VH1 calls. And he's up there talking like about just life and everything. And that was really quite, you know, pleasant and a surprise when it first happened.
Yeah. So. Gary?
Yeah, I would certainly amen what Jacqui just said. That's a question. I mean, that could be a whole, you know, seminar by itself. But some of the quirks, and I was blessed to know him, you know, from the 70s. But no matter how long he knew you, he frequently, and I know Jacqui and Stokely remember this, would call you by your full name. And so he would, you know, call at 2 or 3 in the morning, like it was noon, you know, and say, "Gary Hines, I have an idea for Sounds of Blackness, Gary Hines." And I said, "Okay, what do you think about that, Gary Hines?" And so he would say your full name, no matter how long he knew, frequently. The other thing I think a lot of people don't know is he was an amazing athlete. He went to basketball junior high school, a junior high school, Bryant, and a very sports-oriented Minneapolis Central, where yours truly also went. And to even make the team, you had to be bad, you know. And he was like all city, and a lot of people didn't know that. And so one of the things, he had a hoop, and you know Jacqui out at Paisley, and one of his favorite things would be to invite unbeknownst people for a little one-on-one. You know, because, you know, all the jocks and actors and stuff would come out and visit Paisley, and they didn't know, and they'd be like, "What?" And he'd take them to the hole.
Okay, I'm just gonna remind you guys, if you have anything that is on, we're hearing a little bit of an echo, but we're gonna keep it moving. So maybe if you have other devices on, turn it down so that we can hear you guys clearly. I'm gonna move into Kevin. Kevin has worked with everyone. Give me something that's a misnomer about Prince.
Well, okay, I'm gonna tiptoe through this, so I want everybody to understand I'm tiptoeing here. You know how Prince would, you know, the eyeliner, maybe a little rouge, you know, maybe the heels. People had a perception about him, whether he was, you know, androgynous, or, you know, whether he liked men or women or whatever. Let me just tell you this, knowing him, and I first met a Prince when we were in the third grade. So we go way back, and there was nothing funny about Prince. Prince was a dude, all dude.
Very
Prince
true.
Prince was a borderline pimp.
Yeah.
I mean, seriously, he would talk. He had that game for you. He could come with it. So, you know, he was all man. I just want to say that Prince was my dude. And when I would see him, you know, as we became adults, it was always love, you know. So, but he was always a good brother.
Yeah.
So I just don't, all that other stuff, that was all for show.
For show. Okay. And Stokely, you got a Prince story?
I echo everything they just said, first of all, and what Kevin just said about show and all that. You know, we just got done doing the Call My Name video off of the Musicology CD, and we were out at Sony Studios, and we went to a few different places. We were just hopping around, and he had these lights on the bottom of his, you know, his heels, whatever. He's like, "You should get you some of these." I was like, "Man, only you can wear them, man. I'm not putting them LA. I had the LA gear before. Only you can wear it." He just started laughing. But I miss it. You know, the thing I miss the most is, you know, like everybody said, just his, he would call like 12:30 a.m. when he's like, "What are you doing?" You know, come out to and just to talk, basically.
Right.
You know, and especially the last maybe 4 or 5 years, you know, and he had said to me, it's like, I see, you know, you have this click over here and Jimmy Terry over there, and, you know, everybody's over here. It's like, I want us to be closer. You know, it's like, wow, I would love that. You know, I want people to know who you are. And, you know, I'd like to be involved in what you're doing. Have you ever thought about doing something? Like, Actually, I was in the middle of, you know, finishing my first solo CD. It's like, well, can I be a part of it? I was
wow.
Like, well, yeah. So it was the best thing that never happened. Yeah, you know what I mean? But I feel his spirit will always, his DNA, musical DNA, will always be. It's in me. You know, it's in everything. Man, does a lot of, you know, the Minneapolis artists, us here in Minnesota artists. He carry that spirit. You know, and he's just an amazing. One more thing I thought was really funny. There's this club downtown Minneapolis. I can't remember the name of the club, but it was a group called Conversation Piece. And Chance Hart was also in that group, who also played with Prince. Yeah. And I'm sitting down there playing and I'm singing, and he comes down, and a lot of times he said, "Were you playing tonight?" And I think I told him we were playing. And he comes down there, and next thing, I didn't know when he came in. You know, I would just have my head down. I'm singing from the side and everything, and I just feel something on my head. Like, what is going on? I looked down and rolled up $100 bills, you know. He's throwing them at me. He's like, "Bravo!" Like, over a crack. I'm like,
"Yeah."
What? I mean, just amazing, just fun. Yeah. Just fun.
Wow.
I mean, that's the kind of dude he was. Just always around the clubs, giving love to the local musicians, and
always.
You would never know it, you know.
Yep.
It's really.
Yeah.
He would. As a matter of fact, I think he prided himself on finding people who were just, you know, diamonds in the rough.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you all can attest to that as well, you know.
Absolutely. I think that even with the business side, everybody that he worked with,
right.
And he would take you to that next level. He saw something in every individual that he, when you were close to him, there was a reason why, and he saw something. And at the time, you might not know it, that you had that, right?
Right.
And he'd see it.
Right.
Yeah. So that was pretty special. Yeah.
So
Minneapolis is special too, with the amazing clubs. I mean, literally, you could go and see Gary and Stokley, and then Prince might pop up, and then there was, you know, just so many amazing, amazing musicians. You know, just around town, just to go pay $5 to the Bunkers,
right?
To see Michael Bland jam.
Yeah, right.
$5 to see Michael Bland play. Come on,
right.
Yeah,
true.
Right.
Let's talk about taking it to the next level. We don't have that much more time. You guys have so many stories. We're going to have to do this again, I'm telling you. Let's talk about taking it to the next level and the climate that we're in the United States, around the world right now. And we're talking about taking a stance for social justice. Gary, I want to start off with you. We're going to get ready to show your new single, which is called Sick and Tired. And I want to find out, once we get ready to roll this clip, Sick and Tired, again, 50 years later, Sounds of Blackness is still a relevant group, and you've got out a new single that is relating to the younger generation. So I want you to tell me why you decided to do this and how you're taking a stand for social justice. Let's take a look when it's coming up, Sick and Tired. Okay, so this isn't the new one, Sick and Tired. Yeah, that's not Sick and Tired. We'll find the right one. But Gary, maybe you can, as we're finding it, maybe give us a little background on Sick and Tired, and they're playing this in some of the commercials and campaigns right now, and I see. So kind of give us a little bit of background on Sick and Tired, your latest single.
Oh, absolutely. First of all, the words themselves are from the late, great Fannie Lou Hamer, who in 1964 at the Democratic National Convention told the world that she was sick and tired of being sick and tired of injustice, white supremacy, inequality. So we have to give credit to Fannie Lou Hamer. She's the inspiration behind the word. And Wendy, Brother George Floyd was lynched 5 blocks from where Sounds of Blackness rehearsed. It's the Bethany Community Center in the heart of the South Side Black community. And it was on a Monday, and the first protests were on a Tuesday. And so, of course, a Tuesday is our normal rehearsal night. But, of course, we didn't cancel rehearsal that night. We were all at the protest. There were thousands of people there, red, brown, yellow, black, white, young, old men, women. And this teenage young lady who happened to be Caucasian recognized me from the group, and she came up to me, and she had her Black Lives Matter sign, and she said, "Hey, Mr. Sounds of Blackness, I love you guys, and I bet you guys are going to do a song about this." He said, "But please do me a favor. Don't make it a happy song." And I said, "Young lady, I promise you that will not happen. This is not the time or energy for Kumbaya, and it's not the time, for even the Ecclesiastes tells us there's a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing." The mood in Minneapolis then and now, with the real-time lynching of Brother George Floyd, was one of righteous indignation, anger, and outrage. And so we needed a song that would reflect and capture that, a call to action. Not, in fact, a lot of radio was looking, and I've done several interviews, for Sounds of Blackness to come out with another optimistic Let's Hold Hands. And it's like, not right now.
Well, let's take a look. Yeah. We got it ready. We wanna take a look at Gary's latest single, Sick and Tired. Tired, and you're getting a lot of airplay, and we wish you the best with that song. You're working with Ann Nesby's daughter in this. Ann Nesby was one of the original members, right?
Yes. Okay. And you're talking about Janicia Menon, and she also directed the video.
Oh, wow. Great. Sounds of Blackness is still around, y'all. We're going to be working on something special with you. We'll let them know about that, when time comes. Kevin Fleming, we want to ask you, in terms of a program director, a media owner with Urban Buzz, what kinds of things are you doing in terms of taking a stand that you can for social justice?
Well, it's about awareness, and it's about education. I think that so often people don't know enough about their history. They think that what's going on now is new, and it's really not new. It's the same old, and that's why Gary's song resonates so strongly, sick and tired of being sick and tired. I mean, Marvin Gaye wrote What's Going On in 1971. James Brown did, Say It Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud in the 70s. My God, are we still doing the same thing? Are we still going through the same thing? I have a son, and I had to have the talk with him. I remember my father had a talk with me. I remember one time coming out of flight time in Edina, and the guy stopped by the police. And I'm the vice president and general manager of the company. Could you imagine all the stars that have come through that building and worked there and made songs there? Did they also have trouble with the police in Minneapolis? At a world-class facility like that? So, you know, we have to know who we are. We have to understand what we're doing. Sometimes we bring things on ourselves that are unnecessary, that we, with education and understanding, that we could really, we could curb some of those things, and we need to be more responsible. But I also understand that everything was not set up for us. You know, what we have to do is take care of each other.
Right.
And not fight amongst ourselves, because we can build ourselves up and we can take care of each other. And just being aware and understanding and being respectful to one another is a great place for us to start, because without us, we don't really have anything, because we know what they're doing on the other side. We know how they think of us on the other side.
Yeah. And as you said before, Kevin, we do have the power, and we're going to show that in this election on November 3rd. Everybody come out. That's why we're doing this. Moby Symposium is all of these industry leaders, and we're here for you. We're here to share the knowledge, pass it on to the next generation. Stokely, you're someone that your dad has passed along a lot to you, which I thought was incredible. Tell us about your father and how he was a professor for African American Studies at McAllister College in the 70s, where Gary Hines went. What?
Yeah, a lot. I didn't know for a long time that I was halfway homeschooled. You know, I didn't. It was just, you know, I would go to school, and I would thought everybody was getting the same kind of education. But the real deal was, after I got done, you know, from, you know, the public school education that I had, getting half of the truth and half of that, I would go home and get the real thing, learning about, you know, different parts of the continent in Africa, world history. And I think that's why he could speak so in depth and give a versus, you know, against a black culture, white culture, European culture. And so that's how I was brought up. And I had a very, the importance of community, the village, you know, your tribe. I was very, strong, as far as like black men, it was like they were always in my life.
Role models. And
it was really important. So I think I see that now, as I'm a father, and I say, man, it's so important to have black fathers in the household and to have somebody that can direct you. You know, you think you know, but he's like, you know, there's so many different levels to it. And I would go out, you know, I was just a couple of times I would, you know, stay out. I thought I was all of 16, and you know, you get to know a little bit, and then going out, like, look, man, and we had a little thing. It's like, you don't understand what's going on. And this, like Kevin said, it's a shame that we're still fighting this same situation. I'm a kitty corner from my house. Cop stops me, and you know, he's like, where are you going? It's like, I'm going home. And he thought I was joking. You know, it's like, no, stop playing with me, boy. I'm like, I said, no, look, I live there. I mean, these things, I mean, just that kind of harassment still to this day. But I mean, he was just saying, hey, look, man, you are public enemy number one. Mm-hmm. That was the thing. He would always say that. But you know, it doesn't, there's, you know, you have to make sure that you know how to deal with yourself. So all these things, man, were always, I was always aware, and I always kind of walk with that light, because there's always going to be something happening. And I think for us black folks, is to kind of remember that it's we have a lot to be emotional about.
Right.
I think right now we got to play chess, because they've been playing checkers. It's like the first thing, and rightly so, we get emotional about these things. It's just like, it's been happening so long. We're sick and tired of being sick and tired.
Yeah.
But we have to play a different game right now. You know, it's a different game being played. So the thing that I'm really thankful for is this time we talked about technology. Technology has moved this thing so far along, so quickly, so rapidly after this George Floyd thing. I mean, we've seen, it's the same
Absolutely.
Thing that's been happening, but why it's different. You know, we've always had our white brothers and sisters fighting alongside of us, but it's so vast now. So just because of this whole thing coming into play. And Pops just shared with me that just last week, he was like, you know what? He's lived in all these different decades. He said, you know, this is the best decade. If you had to choose a decade, and I was like, it actually surprised me. He's like, this decade is the one I would choose. Just
really?
Because, you know, I said, not the 60s, not the 60s. He's like, no. I mean, that we were doing it, but I mean, it pales in comparison to what's happening right now. Everything that's happening now was happening then, but it's so much bigger. They haven't seen it. You ask any old timer, they've
right.
seen it. They've went through it. So, I mean, it's happening. It's amazing to see that. And it's an amazing, I always have an amazing time now speaking with them about that. I always have questions like, well, how was it, you know, now versus then, you know? And so, I mean, I realized that I'm definitely blessed, and I, you know, I've had to share him with the community, and if I've been, you know, it's a great thing to see. He's had so many students and so many kids, so to speak. And, you know, he's been a great person to me, kind of pattern. I'll never get there. You know, I'm like, man, how
is he retired? Is he still teaching?
Oh yeah, he calls it his fault. He calls it a withdrawal. He didn't call it retired.
Right.
Okay. Mr. Withdrawal. Yeah, I'm like.
Yeah.
But yeah, but he's,
you know, Stokely.
He's busier now than he, you know, before. It's like trying to catch up with him, you know. Even at the COVID thing, he's always, you know, he's got on the phone, and I have to get him his phone now. So
aww.
Yeah, it's amazing to having seen that. So I've had a great man, seeing him grow up, and I just hoping I can be a little bit of that with my kids.
Yeah. You should know Stokely, he's had a great influence on a whole lot of people.
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
Sir.
I tell him that sometimes I can't travel, and I always know, he's like, oh, I'm a student of your dad's. I'm like, wow, how does, it's like, man, you know, he's like, really?
Well, next time we want to bring him back. Before we let you go, we got about 5 minutes, everyone. Stokely, tell us about your new single, Vibrant, and if we have a quick little clip of it, we'll show it.
Vibrant is a song with featuring my man Snoop Dogg, who I've always loved. You know, we all love Uncle Snoop. And that song is just about my energy that I was trying to put out there, but it was a much bigger thing. I actually, in this whole, it was a little fight, you know, because of everything that's going on with the George Floyd and that whole thing. It was, I talked to quite a few people about it. It's like, is this the kind of thing, you know, because when this thing hit, it all hit us in a way. It's like, it made us reevaluate, you know, in a way, you know, mm-hmm. just, you know, just, I don't know. So I'm just, there are many different ways to protest. And the thing that we know about.
We're showing the video now.
Yeah. Stand up, wanna see your vertical. When we about to go, you won't need your phone.
Need a phone at home, girl.
It's another world metaphysical.
Hey.
It's belief I'm about to fly. All marbles, I ain't tripping, baby, we can take a ride. Ain't no stopping once we get going. No, don't hit the brakes unless you break it down a little more. For me, don't make me wait. I'm saying, let's play. Get you.
Thank you.
I think everybody likes that latest single,
Vibrant.
I hope you all enjoyed. It's from the forthcoming CD, Sankofa, which means go back and get it, which means for me really to remember where you came from. Roller skating was one of those things we used to do back in the day. And just to bring some good feeling within that, and that's kind of also a protest within itself, us being our natural selves, you know, as like, say, for somebody celebrating an end zone. You know, they take that away. So just being our natural, colorful selves. So, I mean, I think there's in this whole thing, just, you know, to wrap it up, there's all kinds of soldiers we have. We have corporate soldiers, there's artist soldiers, you know, there's a blue collar, white collar, so, you know, so we all have our part to do. You know, I think this whole thing that we've been talking about as far as where are our leaders, it's like this day and age, there are a lot of them. I don't think there's just one anymore. There are many of them. There's many, you know, we have so many people, you know, Sister Nakima over Minneapolis, there's so many people doing it. And we just have to champion, you know, and just really rally around this energy right now, and however we can get it, we got to get it. It's like we can't wait.
Right,
we can't wait. It's now.
I love how you guys are collaborating. How did the hookup with Snoop come about?
Well, the song, I actually had that groove for about 12 years. Sometimes you hold on to stuff, and you just hold on to it just till it's right, and it feels like I love like the whole 90s thing, and like so till it came, and just wait till it comes back around again. And it has, you hear all this 90s and 80s thing, which you'll hear a lot of on this Sankofa. And it sounded like him. We reached out for him, and he happened to be a fan of what Mint Condition does and what I've been doing lately with She and all that kind of stuff. So called out, and he was like, "Yeah, I'm on it, man. Let's go."
Awesome. That's awesome. We support you. We your music has just continued to climb, and like I said, years later, everybody's still a big fan. So, you know, continued success on everything you're doing. We will be having a roller skate party now. And people want to know where you can get the song.
Yes. Well, actually, on so you can stream it. It's on 10/7 of next month. It's going to be streaming everywhere, whether it be Apple, you know, Amazon, all the platforms. Yeah.
Actually, that's next week. Can you believe it? We are already going into October.
Here we go.
And we're crazy. And
let me mention that Vibrant is in the top 15 this week.
Kevin has Urban Buzz that he continues to uplift and give the information about all the latest releases and stuff like that. I mean, that's amazing.
And let me just say, Stokley and Gary are not only my friends, but also my clients.
I love it.
Tell us a little bit about
urbanbuzz.com. www.theurbanbuzz.com. Please, we talk about music, urban music, new releases, information in the business, what's going on. It's just a kind of an awareness for what's happening right now. So I encourage everybody to check it out. But let me just say one thing. I really want to just say thank you to everybody. You bring so much. You've done so much. You continue to do much. And I'm a fan. And anything I can do to help anybody, just hit me up. I'm there for you. We'll get down together.
Right.
Thank you. I love it.
We have a few minutes. I want to give Jacqui, you know, any closing comments, anything that you want to let us know that you're working on in terms of your foundation for Prince. And I know that you're still giving back, you know, in terms of him when he was vegan. And you're doing stuff for a lot of inner city kids. I love it. Gardens, Prince was vegan. Tell us about some of the initiatives and things that you're working on.
Yeah, so he was into so many different things giving, from solar panels to tech programs to gardening. And so we whittled it down, came up with a few different missions that we wanted to do. So we focus on kids in music, arts, and tech programs. And we also focus on urban farming and gardening in inner cities. And so last year, it feels like years and years ago now, we were in Detroit and we gave organic garden wall to a community center. And that did garden. So it's all about giving back. And that's where we're coming from. We have a lot of stuff that we're going to be doing next year. We're going to be creating a membership platform moving forward. We have merchandise now. We do panels to, let people know about Prince's the background. Like, this would be an amazing panel, guys. And we just did one. We did one with Sinbad. Amazing women, Candy Dolfer, Maite, Cora Coleman, Rhonda Smith, Shelby J, and Kat Dyson. And they were all women that perform with Prince and MPG. And just talking about that, and then we raised money for Chance Howard, who we were just talking about conversation piece. And he was the keyboard player for Prince, and he had a really terrible accident. So we helped alumni in need as well. We helped Rosie Gaines, who is a singer with Diamonds and Pearls. And she, that's what we're here to do, is help alumni work with kids and connect kids to amazing art programs. And we'll be doing some really cool stuff. So very excited. And it's all inspired by Prince and what he gave. And we want to pass it on and keep it going. And I think that's how we're going to do it, through music and what you're doing, Gary, and you know, with the songs and the connection, Stokely, all music is the connector. It connects us all, and it's a way to inspire and bring us all together.
Great. So, and tell us the website again that people can go and even buy some of the things that are special for Prince, like his fairy vanilla candles and different things that he liked to set.
Absolutely. He was definitely a set the moon person. So you go in the studio, and it was all about smell and vibe and lighting and everything, you know, to get there. It was everything that made that vibe. So we created candles. We have t-shirts and hats and that. And the website is prnalumni.org. And, you know, you can find out more about what we're doing and, you know, support us by, you know, getting the merchandise and checking out the panels.
Thank you so much. I want to close it out with Gary. And Gary, any last thoughts? And thank you so much. It's wonderful to know that, again, Sounds of Blackness is celebrating 5 decades, and you are the originator and the person that has kept it together. So kudos to you.
Yay!
And we're going to champion
institution.
That. We're going to champion that and get that played wherever we can right now for this whole, wow, you know, inauguration that will be coming up. Let's see. So any closing comments?
Yes. A couple of quick things. I know we're right at the end. First of all, I'm going to shout out to Professor Michael Mundell-Cotti, Stokely's dad. He told us 50 years ago when we were students in the Cowboy, I was a student, I'm the only original currently. He said, don't just be a band, be an institution. And so shout out to him. And then we want to let everybody know that if you go to Sounds of Blackness website, soundsofblackness.org, real easy, to either buy Sick and Tired or everybody's, people have asked about the t-shirts in the video. You'll not only be picking that up, but we're donating a portion of the proceeds to the George Floyd Scholarship Fund. So you'll be supporting the cause as well. And we will be in touch with you there. So just soundsofblackness.org. And of course, Sick and Tired is available, you know, on all the regular formats. And call radio and ask them to play. Kevin, thank you for your support, brother. Some, believe it or not, some so-called black radio has said some reluctance about playing it because they don't want to offend people. Mm. And I had to say, and y'all excuse me, you mean you're concerned about offending people with the words of Fannie Lou Hamer, Sick and Tired, but you're not afraid of offending people with Wet Ass Pussy.
Oh goodness! Okay,
I had to go there.
Hey,
it's true, right? It's true. The lyrics and the songs, and you guys are keeping it real and keeping it positive.
Say it, man.
Yes, exactly. Okay, so well, you guys have been incredible. I mean, we're out of time, but I want to really thank all of you guys for joining me today. It's been insightful, and we could go on and on. Thank you to Mr. Gary D. Hines from Sounds of Blackness and singer Stokley and all the great, wonderful things he's doing. Kevin Fleming, program director of KPFK Los Angeles and the Urban Buzz. And of course, my new friend over here, Jacqui Thompson, who's president of PRN Alumni Foundation. I also want to thank Pat Shields, who is the producer and
Thank you, Pat.
Your diligent work, as well as Gwendolyn Kelly, Curtis Simons, and Miss Yvette Moyo. I will be back again because we have more to talk about another time. But right now, I want to thank everybody for tuning in, and I'm going to turn it over to Yvonne, who has a couple last words. Thank you guys so much. And of course,
thank you. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Wendy. We're just a few weeks away from the opening of the highly anticipated National Museum of African American Music in Nashville. In this special Tuesday edition, we will hear about NMOM's initiatives of preserving and celebrating Black music and its contribution to American culture. Tune in tomorrow to hear Tuisha Roger Simpson, Vice President of Brand and Partnerships at the Museum, who will lead the discussion with Peter Caden, Vice President Marketing and Empire, Lynn Scott, Vice President of Marketing and HITCO, and Brandon Pankey, Vice President of Business Development and Operations at Live Nation. Let's talk about how Black artists are marketed in the industry and how the increase of digital content has transformed how music is released and consumed. Tune in tomorrow. We'll be live on Facebook at Moby Symposium page, as well as the YouTube channel. And now, back to Yvette Moya.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much for such a wonderful panel. I mean, Moby, Marketing Opportunities in Business and Entertainment, moves with a sense of history, purpose, and culture, and you guys brought it. In addition, our nonprofit that presents this conference is Real Men Charities, and I will say to the brothers on the panel, thank you for carrying forth the spirit every day in what you produce and what you say and how you carry yourself. It shows that you had the influence of Stokely's father and that something different was happening in Minneapolis. I'm just so inspired by it. Real men love. It's one of our hashtags that we use and we can see it. And without that foundation of history, purpose, and mission, people would rather give us a lobotomy, but they can't do that. They can't take away our brains. and our cultural soul cannot be compromised if we move with that kind of platform. To the ladies on the panel, to your efforts to Jacqui to really memorialize and capitalize as we should and have those streams come right back into our community, I commend you. And of course, Wendy, you've done an excellent job at dealing with some wonderful people who have come off as just regular Black folks with high talent that have the stage. We are no way sick and tired of anything that we've talked about today, nor of carrying forth the fight that we have economic justice and social justice and justice in the courts. We got to vote. We got to be there. I just have to say that because if we're not engaged, we're not making a difference. And you guys are. Thank you so much for being here tonight.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
And thanks to our audience. Good night, okay. Everyone.
Bye-bye. Continue to be inspired, everyone. Thank you.
Moby, thank you.